Yes, hello friends, good evening. Am I audible? Please somebody ping me. Yes guys, am I audible? Please somebody ping me so that I can start the session. Okay. Hello everyone, welcome to Unacademy, India's largest online learning platform. Let's crack UPSC CSE English. Now, before I start the session, let me introduce myself for the people who are new on the platform or who are attending my session for the first time. My name is Alok Ojha. I have done my engineering from Pune. I have been associated with the field of UPSC since past 7 years. I hold the experience of giving CDS SSB twice. I also hold the experience of exams like Assistant Commandant, CAPF Assistant Commandant and Uttar Pradesh PSC. I am involved into the field of teaching since past 5 years and I have mentored more than 10,000 aspirants for UPSC. Today we are going to discuss one of the most important topics from the perspective of prelims, that is Gupta Empire. There might be a question in the mind of an aspirant why one should prefer Unacademy as a platform for online learning. So here are the ample of reasons why one should prefer Unacademy as a platform for online learning. First of all, you'll have daily life classes on the Unacademy platform. Unacademy offers you assimilation of top and dynamic educators of India on a single platform. You can directly interact with the educators. You can clear all sorts of doubts with the educators. Second most important aspect, Unacademy helps to build up your competence by going through live tests and quizzes. All the courses on Unacademy platform are highly structured in nature and there is a proper timetable through which the courses are being conducted. And one can have unlimited access to the courses on Unacademy platform. Here are the few top and dynamic educators of India from whom you are going to learn through. Now, Unacademy covers a syllabus in a very comprehensive manner. There is a complete focus on each and every aspect of GS, ranging from history, geography, economics, polity, science and tech, current affairs. There is proper focus on the answer writing techniques. There is a proper focus on the essay writing and so on. Apart from that, there is also complete focus on the optional subjects as well. Like, there is a proper focus on the humanities optional like sociology, psychology, philosophy. Apart from that, there is also a focus on the literature part like Hindi literature, English literature, Kannada literature, Maithili literature and so on. Now, there is also something called as iconic subscription. Now, what is majorly iconic subscription all about? During the initial days, the preparation is completely haphazard. And an aspirant is majorly confused about what should I read, where should I read from where should I start my preparation, what right strategy that needs to be chalked down. How much time should I dedicate to read the current affairs? Which optional should I choose? So there would be a mentor who would be guiding you throughout your journey for civil services preparation. That is majorly iconic subscription all about. So if you choose me as your mentor, please use my code AKOUS. I repeat the code AKOUS. Now Unacademy has come up with Unacademy Combat. Now it would be held on 14th of Feb and it is held every fortnight. It would be held at 11 a.m. So you can enroll for the Unacademy Combat by using my code AKOUS. So 60 minutes, 60 questions and there would be a relative scoring so that one can gauge his competitiveness or preparation. Rank 1 to 10 would be getting 1 month UPSC GS Plus subscription. These are the special classes and subscription courses conducted by me previously. So please do subscribe to Unacademy and use my code AKOUS. I repeat the code AKOUS. Yes. Good evening, Banita. Good evening, Muskan. Good evening, Monisha. Yes, Prashant. All the playlists are available. Okay, directly you can go on Let's Crack UPSC CSE English channel. There you can search Alok Ojha. You will get all the sessions on Ancient India, Medieval India and Modern India. Okay. Now, let's talk about Gupta Empire. Now, it is considered as Sri Gupta was the founder of Gupta Empire and he was son of a local warrior named as Ghatotkach. Now, how do we come to know that Sri Gupta was the founder of Gupta Empire? Like many historical records says that, like it is believed that many historical texts says that Chandragupta I was the founder of Gupta Empire. But majorly, there is an inscription in Pune. That is referred as Pune Copper Inscription. and that inscription is of Prabhavati Gupta. And the Prabhavati Gupta was daughter of one of the rulers, Chandragupta II. And in that inscription, it has been mentioned that Maharaj Sri Gupta was the founder of Gupta dynasty. So from here onwards, we come to know that Sri Gupta was the actual founder of Gupta dynasty and not the Chandragupta one. So probably there might be a question in the UPSC prelims exam. From where do we come to know that Sri Gupta was the founder of Gupta dynasty? We come to know that Sri Gupta was the founder of Gupta dynasty from the inscriptions of Prabhavati Gupta. Okay. Now there was a Chinese traveler whose name was Yi Jing. And according to Yi Jing, basically, Sri Gupta ordered the construction of a temple called as Mrigshikhavan. And basically the temple Mrigshikhavan was for those Buddhist pilgrims who are coming from China. Okay. And basically who are attending what we say, those pilgrims who are going to place called as Bodh Gaya for worshipping Lord Buddha. So for them, a specific what we say temple was constructed named as Mrigshikhavan. So these many things occurred majorly during the tenure of whom? Sri Gupta. Now moving further. Chandragupta I was a very diplomatic ruler. And he believed that if we continuously keep on waging war with the other kingdoms, probably there might be possibility of losing men and material both. That is why through an act of diplomacy, he entered into matrimonial alliances. He entered into marriage alliances. And here it is believed that he married Kumar Devi, who was a Lichavi princess, and he got Patliputra in dowry. Like basically, as per Manu Smriti, there are majorly four castes: Brahmin, Kshatriya, Vaishya and Shudra. Now for Guptas were majorly Vaishyas, and for them marriage to Kshatriya was considered as a matter of privilege for them. So that is why Chandragupta I continuously kept on expanding his kingdom by entering into the policy of matrimonial alliances. As I have given an example, he married Kumar Devi and she was a Lichavi princess. And in that case, he got Patliputra in dowry. Now, he assumed the title Maharaja Dhiraj. Maharaja basically means king. And what is Maharaja Dhiraj? King of kings. And from where do we come to know about the ruler Chandragupta I? We come to know about Chandragupta I from Mehroli Iron Pillar inscription, which is located near Delhi. Mehroli is located quite close to Delhi. So we come to know from Mehroli Pillar inscription about whom? We come to know about Chandragupta I. He is also founder of Gupta era, that is 320 AD, and his empire extended as far as Allahabad. Did you understand the point still here, guys? Please let me know. Umesh, you have asked me a question that yes, that's what I said. Ki there are many historical texts which says that Chandragupta I was the actual founder. But if we see the properly things, Sri Gupta was considered as the founder because the evidence comes from copper plate inscription, which is located at Pune. And this copper plate inscription majorly belongs to Gupta dynasty ruler itself. That is why we have to follow that historical record. Are the points clear, Umesh? Yes, Sri Shai, good evening. Yes, are the points clear? Please let me know. Okay, now listen to me very carefully. Chandragupta I was succeeded by his son Samudragupta. And Samudragupta is considered not only the greatest ruler of the Gupta Empire, but also one of the greatest ruler of ancient India. Like Ashoka, he was also an imperialist. And he believed in one concept, Chakravartin and Dharni Bandh. I repeat, Chakravartin and Dharni Bandh. So what is Chakravartin and Dharni Bandh? This entire universe is one. And there should be only one ruler for that entire universe. And that ruler would be Samudragupta. So he considered himself as Chakravartin, one ruler of all the four directions. Now, by Vincent Smith, he is also called as Napoleon of India. Why he is referred as Napoleon of India? Because of his policy of conquest. because of his tyrannical policy of imperialism, of continuously expanding one's kingdom. That is why he is also referred as Napoleon of India. We come to know majorly about Samudragupta, majorly about the conquest made by the Samudragupta from Allahabad pillar inscription. And Allahabad pillar inscription is majorly written by Hari Sen. He was a court, like he was majorly a court poet in the court of Samudragupta. And Allahabad inscription majorly describes about the conquest, various degrees of subjugation that were brought by the ruler Samudragupta. Like, initially from Pataliputra, Samudragupta wanted to conquer the kingdom towards the southern part of Pataliputra. And here, he had to face a lot of local revolts. Because there were small principal kingdom who were continuously raising their hands against the Gupta Empire. His first task was to defeat and bring all the kings under various degrees of subjugation to the south of Pataliputra. 12 kingdoms were brought under various degrees of subjugation immediately after this. Then later on, 8 kingdoms of the northwestern part, and specifically one of the most powerful among them was Kota Kingdom, which was in the region of Punjab. So there were 8 kings who had clubbed themselves. Okay, and these 8 kingdoms directly attacked Samudragupta. But Samudragupta again emerged victorious. Now Samudragupta focused his attention on 9 tribal republics and the kingdoms of the forest areas. Like they are also border states, they are also called as Pratyant. I've mentioned here, like Samtaka, which was in East Bengal, that is present day Bangladesh, Dawak in Assam, Kamrup again in Assam, Nepal and Kartipura in Kashmir. So all the border states, all the tribal republics, all the neighboring kingdoms were brought under various degrees of subjugation by Samudragupta. Okay, he also defeated the Kushan dynasty rulers, who are also referred as Devaputra. There was the ruler of in the southern part of India, like there were rulers who tried to challenge his authority. Like the rulers of Sri Lanka tried to challenge his authority. In fact, even they were defeated. And where do we come to know about the different conquest about the Samudragupta? We come to know about the various conquests made by Samudragupta from Allahabad pillar inscription. And Allahabad pillar inscription, the author of that inscription is who? Hari Sen. Now from the inscription also we come to know that Samudragupta is also referred as Kaviraj. Why he is referred as a Kaviraj? Because he was a great poet as well. He liked composing various verses. He also liked playing Veena. Like it is said that in one of his coins, it is depicted that Samudragupta was playing Veena. Okay? See, Hinduism consists of Vaishnavism, Shaivism and Shaktiism. Vaishnavism basically means worship of Lord Ram or Lord Vishnu or Lord Krishna. Shaivism consists of worship of Lord Shiva. And Shaktiism consists of worship of goddess. So Gupta dynasty rulers were majorly the followers of Vaishnavism. Okay, they were majorly the followers of Vaishnavism. Like it is believed that he was a follower of Lord Vishnu, but still he revered and respected all the other religions. Now there was a ruler of Sri Lanka whose name was Meghavarman. Now he wanted to construct a monastery at a place called as Bodh Gaya, where Lord Buddha had attained enlightenment or Nirvana. Then the ruler at this time was who? Samudragupta. Samudragupta granted the permission for constructing the monastery at Bodh Gaya. That is why he is also called as Anukampavava. I repeat, Anukampavava. That means a compassionate ruler. A ruler who always helps the other. He was also known for performing all sorts of Ashwamedha Yajna. Now why Ashwamedha Yajna is performed? Ashwamedha Yajna is usually performed to expand one's kingdom. So a lot many Ashwamedha Yajna were being performed by Samudragupta. And it is believed that one of the horses that was used for Ashwamedha Yajna, the statue of horse was also made. And that statue presently is kept in Lucknow Museum. Okay. Now, he issued a lot of gold and silver coins, and he was a great patron of a Buddhist monk or a Buddhist scholar, Vasubandhu. Okay. His empire extended in the northwest to the southern parts of India. Okay. His empire extended from eastern, that is Bay of Bengal, to the Saurashtra or Arabian Sea in the west. So approximately entire India came under the sway of Samudragupta. And because of his courage, because of his bravery, because of his valor, he is compared with various Vedic gods like Indra, who is god of war, god of strength, Kuber, who is god of wealth. So he is also referred as Paramapurush and compared with various Vedic gods. So this is majorly about Samudragupta. My friends, did you understand this? Please let me know. Yes guys, did you understand this? Any doubt, any question, any sort of query, please ask me. Okay. Now let's talk about Chandragupta II. Samudragupta was succeeded by his son, whose name was Chandragupta II. And Chandragupta II is also referred as Vikramaditya. Now, it is believed that immediately after Samudragupta, his elder son Ramgupta became the ruler. But Ramgupta was a ruler for a short span of time, and immediately he was succeeded by his younger brother, whose name was Chandragupta II and is also referred as Vikramaditya. Like the Chandragupta I, he was also a very diplomatic ruler. Like, he believed that rather than wasting men and material, he believed in the policy of consolidating the kingdom, expanding the kingdom, and entering into the policy of matrimonial alliances. Now, almost northern part of India, certain parts of southern India, and certain parts of western India were under the Gupta Empire. Certain parts of eastern India were under the Gupta Empire, except western India. Because western India was under Sakas. And now what happened? Let us understand this. There is a historical text called as Devi Chandraguptam, and here it has the entire plot has been mentioned. Now what did Chandragupta II do? He married a Naga princess from central India, whose name was Kuber Nag. And from Kuber Nag, he had a daughter, Prabhavati Gupta. If you remember the name, just while back in Sri Gupta, I have talked about this. Pune copper plate inscription, Prabhavati Gupta. So, this person, Chandragupta II, married the Naga princess from central India, whose name was Kuber Nag. And from her, he had a daughter named as Prabhavati Gupta. Now he wanted to strengthen his position in central India and in the region of Deccan. So what did he do? He married his daughter Prabhavati Gupta to Rudrasen II. He was a Vakataka ruler in the region of Deccan. I repeat, he was a Vakataka ruler in the region of Deccan. Now what happened? Few years later, this person Rudrasen II died. And Prabhavati Gupta became the virtual ruler of the region of Deccan or Vakataka kingdom. And in fact, if Prabhavati Gupta is ruler, she had a lot of influence of her father, Chandragupta II, in the administration. And now, this was seen as an opportunity by Chandragupta II to completely overthrow the rule of Sakas from the region of Malwa, which is in Western MP and Gujarat. So, this was seen as an opportunity by Chandragupta II to completely smash out the rule of whom? The rule of Sakas. And now the Sakas were overthrown after 3 to 4 centuries. And now Ujjain became the alternate capital of the Guptas in the western India. In the eastern part of India, the capital was Pataliputra. And now in the western part of India, Ujjain became the alternate capital of Guptas now. Okay? He issued a variety of gold coins, and these gold coins are referred as dinar. He also patronized various scholars like Kalidas and Amar Simha. Kalidas is a poet, he is a dramatist, he is a playwright, and many more things about him. So Kalidas and Amar Simha were patronized by Chandragupta II. Like it is said that in one of his coins, he is depicted slaying down or killing of a lion. Like he is hunting a lion or he is killing a lion. That is why in one of his coins he is depicted as Simhavikram, that is slayer of lion. Now there was one Chinese pilgrim whose name was Fahin, and Fahin visited India. Fahin visited India. My friends, am I audible? Please somebody ping me. Yes, Anshuman. Mr. Anshuman, am I audible properly? Yes, guys, am I audible? Yes, guys, please let me know, am I audible? Yes, guys, am I audible? Okay, thank you. Now there was a Chinese traveler whose name was Fahin. He visited the kingdom of Gupta Empire during the reign of Chandragupta II. Now, he followed a very different route while coming into India. Like initially he started his journey from China. The place was called as Khotan. Then he entered on the border of Afghanistan and Kyrgyzstan through a place called as Kashgar. Then he entered Gandhar, which is in Afghanistan-Pakistan border. And then he entered into Punjab, India. So he came by land route. He visited many places in India. He visited kingdoms like Kannauj, Shravasti, Kushinagar, Pataliputra, Vaishali, Mathura, and so on. He in fact also visited many kingdoms of southern India. And finally, he went by sea route to his country. He visited countries like Sri Lanka, that is Ceylon, Java, and through sea route, he went to his country. So Fahin entered into India through land route, but he exited India through sea route. Now what was the major purpose of Fahin coming into India? The major purpose of Fahin coming into India was to collect the Buddhist manuscript from India. But he was not allowed to collect the Buddhist manuscript from India. So he stayed in Pataliputra and copied all the Buddhist text. Okay, and now Fahin, in his travelogue, has given a very vivid description about the Gupta society, about the economy. But he wrote very little about the political and the administrative structure of the Gupta period. Like it is said that the kingdom was quite flourishing. People were free to cultivate any sort of crops. India was a land of Brahmanism. Now listen to me carefully. After the Vedic civilization, there was a decline of Hinduism and rise of Jainism and Buddhism. But with the revival of Gupta period, there was a revival of Hinduism. That is why Gupta age is also referred as golden age of temple architecture in India. So Fahin has mentioned that India was a land of Brahmanism, but still there was Buddhism, Jainism and various other religions. But the most important aspect that we need to understand here is there was a deep reverence for each and every religion by the ruler. I have just given you an example of Samudragupta. Although Samudragupta was a staunch follower of Vishnu, he was a staunch follower of Vaishnavism, but still he allowed the ruler Meghavarman to construct the monastery at a place called as Bodh Gaya. This shows a deep respect for all the other religions. Okay, Hindu god and goddesses are depicted on the gold on the coins issued by the Gupta rulers. This has been mentioned by Fahin. penal code, like in the modern period, we have seen that criminal code was very severe and death penalty was a very common event during the reign of modern dynasty rulers. But during the reign of Guptas, basically, the what we say punishment was not that cruel. So all these things has been mentioned by Faheen in his travelogue about the Gupta dynasty. So this is majorly about Chandragupta II. So did you understand Chandragupta II? Please let me know. Yes, Muskan, majorly one needs to cover prehistoric culture, Indus Valley civilization. Then after Indus Valley civilization, Vedic civilization. After that, one needs to cover this one, Mahajanpad, Mauryan Empire, Gupta Empire, Mahajanpad, Mauryan Empire, Gupta Empire, Buddhism, Jainism, Harshvardhan, Shungas, Kanvas, Satvahan, Sakas. These are the major topics that one needs to cover in the ancient India from the perspective of prelims. Hope so, Muskan, I have answered your question. Please let me know. Okay, now let's talk about Kumaragupta I. Okay, now Chandragupta II was succeeded by his son Kumaragupta I. Now Kumaragupta I performed lot many Ashwamedh sacrifices. He performed lot many yagnas. That is why he is also referred as Mahendra Aditya or Ashwamedh Mahendra. Now it is believed that he was worshipper of Lord Kartikeya, the elder son of Lord Shiva. Now, one of the striking feature here, majority of the Gupta dynasty rulers were worshippers of Vaishnavism, that is either Lord Krishna or Lord Vishnu or Lord Ram. But Kumaragupta I was worshipper of whom? Kumaragupta I was worshipper of Kartikeya. Okay, and he was given the title Mahendra Aditya or Ashwamedh Mahendra. He laid the foundation of Nalanda University, and Nalanda University was a seat of Buddhist learning since the ancient times. At that time, more than 8,000 to 10,000 students were enrolled in the Nalanda University, and there were many students from abroad who had come here to study the Buddhist manuscripts. So he laid the foundation of Nalanda Universities. Okay, then comes Skandagupta. Now at that time, Hunas were trying to invade India, and he was quite successful in saving India from the attack of Huna rulers. Okay, to an extent, he tried to safeguard the position of Guptas from the Huna dynasty rulers. And now that is why he assumed the title, like his grandfather Chandragupta II, Vikram Aditya. Okay, and we come to know about Skandagupta from Bhitari pillar inscription, which is located at Ghazipur in Uttar Pradesh. And there are other rulers like Purugupta, Narsingagupta, Buddhagupta. And the last ruler was Bal Aditya or Vishnugupta, who was finally thwarted and overthrown by Hunas. So this is majorly about the Gupta dynasty rulers. Please let me know if you understood the points. Yes, Prashant, you will get the PDF on the Telegram channel, that is unacademy_AlokOjha. Okay guys, so now let's talk about the Gupta administration. You will find certain amount of similarity between the administration of the Guptas and the administration of the Mauryas. And what similarities you will find here, let us understand this. Now, king was at the apex of the administration, and the Gupta rulers believed in the theory of divinity of the ruler. Now, what is the meaning of divine origin of the ruler or divinity of the ruler? Divine origin of the ruler basically means that Gupta rulers had been sent by the god to rule over the people. That is the meaning of theory of divinity or divine origin of the ruler. That is why just I have talked about Samudragupta. He is compared to various Vedic gods like Indra, Kuber, Agni, Yam. So there are many Gupta rulers who are compared to Vedic gods, which simply says that they believed in divine origin of the ruler. They believed in the theory of divinity of the king. Now, there are many Gupta rulers who are also compared to the god Vishnu. Like if you see the coins of Gupta rulers, either you will observe the symbol of eagle, which is the vehicle of Lord Vishnu on the coins, or directly you will see Lakshmi, that is goddess of prosperity, on the Gupta coins. Okay, now Gupta rulers assume titles like Parmeshwaram, Parmeshwar Bhatarak or Param Bhatarak, Maharaja Dhiraj. As we have seen, Chandragupta I, one of the rulers of Gupta dynasty, had assumed the title King of Kings, that is Maharaja Dhiraj. This person, Samudragupta, he had assumed the title Chakravarti, single universal ruler of all the four directions. There are rulers who had assumed the title Parmeshwar because they are directly compared to the Vedic gods. Others are referred as Param Bhatarak. Okay? Now, Gupta rulers appointed all the governors. They appointed all the ministers. All the ministers were majorly personally chosen by the Gupta dynasty rulers. Okay? Now, Gupta rulers were quite diplomatic in nature as well. Like, they maintained one system that is called as Samanta system. Now, what is Samanta system all about? Maintaining diplomatic relations with the neighboring kingdom. That is the meaning of Samanta system. Why diplomatic relations are maintained with the neighboring kingdom? Let us understand this. Suppose there is one kingdom and just there are 3 to 4 neighboring kingdoms. And at a quite a distance, there are 2 to 3 kingdoms which are the enemies of Guptas. And the neighboring kingdoms are neither enemies nor friends. But still, they will maintain diplomatic relations with these rulers. Why? Because if the distant rulers decide to attack them, what will happen? These rulers will act as a buffer for them. Okay, that system is called a Samanta system. That is maintaining good and diplomatic relations with the neighboring rulers. So Samanta system was followed in the administration by the Gupta rulers. Administration was highly centralized. The king was a supreme source of justice. Although there was a proper judicial system, but the final source of justice was whom? The final source of justice was king himself. Okay? Like we have seen in the modern dynasty ruler, the king was assisted in the performance of duties by whom? Council of ministers. And these council of ministers are referred as Mantri Parishad. Now Mantri Parishad will be represented by one single minister, and he would be called as Prime Minister or Pradhana Mantri. There can be a comparative analysis question in the prelims exam between modern empire and Gupta empire. If you remember, in the modern empire, I've spoken that basically in the modern empire, king was assisted in performance of his duty by Mantri Parishad, and Mantri Parishad was headed by Mantri Parishad Adhyaksha. Here as well, king was assisted in performance of duties by whom? Mantri Parishad. And Mantri Parishad was represented by whom? It was represented by Pradhan Mantri or Prime Minister. Okay? Now there are various portfolios. There are various departments. And these departments are headed by various officers. Like, Commander-in-Chief of the Army. He was referred as Mahabal Dhikrat. Okay? What is Mahanarpati? He was the head of foot soldiers, that is infantry. Mahashwapati, Ashwa means horse. So Mahashwapati was the head of cavalry department. Mahamahipalpati or Mahagajpati, He was the head of elephants department. Okay? Like infantry was headed by Mahanarpati. Cavalry was headed by Mahaashwapati. Then elephant section was headed by Mahamahipalpati or Mahagajpati. And the entire defense system was headed by Commander-in-Chief, referred as Mahabaladikrat. But during the reign of certain rulers, there was no, what we say, Commander-in-Chief. Like Samudragupta, he personally led his army. There was no Commander-in-Chief. Then Chandragupta, there was no Commander-in-Chief. Skandagupta, there was no Commander-in-Chief. They personally led their armies. Okay? Then Sarva Adhyaksha. The name itself speaks. Sarva, all the department. A person or an officer who is made responsible to scrutinize all the department is referred as Sarva Adhyaksha. He was inspector of all the department. Okay? Then comes Chief Justice. Who is going to dispense justice? A judge. And how he is going to dispense justice? By giving punishment to the criminal. And what is punishment? Dand. So Mahadandanayak. What is that? Chief Justice. So you guys need to remember all these officers properly. So I'll repeat the points again. Pay attention properly. King was at the apex of the administration. King assumed the titles like Parmeshwar, Maharaja Dhiraj, Parambhatarak. He was compared to various Vedic gods like Vishnu, Kuber, Yam and Indra, so on. It is believed that King was assisted in the performance of duties by Council of Ministers. These Council of Ministers are referred as Mantri Parishad, and Mantri Parishad would be headed by Pradhan Mantri. In very simple words, Pradhan Mantri acted as a channel of communication between Mantri Parishad and the king. All the department or all the portfolios were personally chosen by the king. Who is going to head which department? It would be decided by the ruler, by the king himself. So, I'll give you a few examples. Mahanarpati, head of infantry department. Mahaashwapati, head of cavalry department. Mahipalpati, head of elephants department. Mahabaladhikrat, he was commander-in-chief. Mahadandanayak, chief justice, and the other officers. Did you get the points till here? Please let me know, guys. Yes. Yes, good evening, Subhana. Yes, Monisha, like the ring fence policy of the Britishers. Did you understand the points, guys? Yes, guys, are the points clear till here? Okay. Now, like the modern empire, entire Gupta Empire was also divided into small provinces. I'll give you a small example. Presently, we have central government in the center. It is divided into provinces. Provinces are further divided into small districts. Districts are further divided into certain cities or tehsils or town, which is further divided into villages. Same pattern you will observe in the Gupta administration. At the central level, who is going to manage the administration? At the central level, the administration would be managed by the ruler himself, by the king himself, and he would be assisted by Council of Ministers, and these Council of Ministers would be headed by Pradhan Mantri. Okay? Now, it is further divided into small provinces, and the provinces during Gupta period were referred as Bhukti. I repeat, the provinces during the Gupta period were referred as Bhukti. And who is going to head the Bhukti? It would be headed by governor. Who is going to appoint the governor? King himself will appoint the governor. And usually the governors are from the royal blood. Okay, so provinces during the Gupta period are referred as Bhukti. Okay, and Bhuktis would be headed by governor who are referred as Uparikas. Who is going to appoint these Uparikas or governor? These Uparikas or governors would be appointed by the king himself. And they are basically from the royal family. And that is why they are called as Kumar Amatya. I repeat, they are referred as Kumar Amatya. Now moving further. Now these provinces are divided into small districts. These districts are referred as Pradesh. And these Pradesh are headed by Ayukta. I repeat, provinces are called as Bhukti. Bhukti is headed by Uparika, that is governor. Now provinces are further divided into district. District are called as Pradesh, and Pradesh is headed by Ayukta. Moving further, please do not get confused. Please try and understand the hierarchy. Okay. Now, further the districts are divided into small towns or tehsil. These town or tehsil are referred as Pura and is headed by Purapal. And there are certain cities which are also referred as Nagar and is headed by Nagar Sreshti. I repeat the points again. Please listen to me very, very carefully. At the central level, there is king. King is assisted in the performance of duties by Council of Ministers, which are referred as Mantri Parishad. Mantri Parishad is headed by Pradhan Mantri. Okay? Mantri Parishad is headed by Pradhan Mantri. Now there are various departments. And who is going to head this department? Amatya or Minister. Who is going to decide them? Or who is going to distribute the portfolios among them? The ruler or the king. Moving further. Okay. Now, after this, the empire is divided into provinces. Who is going to head the province? Uparika. What are the provinces called? Bhukti. And who are Uparikas? These are governor. They will be appointed by the king and they belong to the royal family. Okay. These are further divided into district. District is referred as Pradesh, and Pradesh is headed by Ayukta. Moving further, it is divided into town. Town is referred as Pura, and Pura is headed by Purapal. And there are cities which are referred as Nagar, and Nagar is headed by Nagar Sreshti. And in the cities, there are group of merchants. This question was asked in the UPSC prelims exam. What is Sarthwaha? Sarthwaha is nothing but guild of merchants prevalent in the cities. So this is majorly about the cities. Moving further, village would be headed by Gramapati. The basic unit of administration is village. And village will be headed by whom? Gram Yeka or Gram Adhyaksh or Gramapati. Okay. And each village had an assembly. Who is going to select? The assembly will be electing the Gram Adhyaksh or Gramapati or Gramika amongst themselves. So initially I had said the power is highly centralized, but here we can see that at least at the grassroots level, the powers are decentralized. Okay. And they gave complete autonomy to the villages. Like everyone was free to cultivate any crops. In fact, they can even levy a small amount of taxes. And group of villages were referred as Viti. I repeat, the group of villages were called as Viti. My friends, please do not get confused. Viti and Vishti both are different. Viti means group of villages. And Vishti means forced labor. I repeat the points. There was a question asked in the UPSC prelims exam. What is Vishti? Vishti is nothing but forced labor. And what is Viti? Viti is nothing but group of villages prevalent during the Gupta period. So did you understand the administrative hierarchy, guys? Please let me know. Yes, guys, did you understand this? Yes, please. Any doubt, any query, any sort of question? Okay. Now let's talk about the taxation system. Like the modern period, here as well, the what we say land revenue was a chief source of income for Gupta rulers as well. Now what is Bali? Bali is nothing but voluntary offering. Okay. For example, suppose if I am a ruler, I conquer the opposite kingdom, and when I conquer the opposite kingdom, I perform one small yagna so that the people of the opposite kingdom also accept me as their ruler. So they will give me a certain voluntary offering. Excuse me. That is called as Bali. Bhaga, spoils of war. After conquering the kingdom, the entire things belongs to the other winning kingdom. That is called as spoils of war. Bhaga. Bhoga, tax in kind of gifts, flowers, anything. Okay. Hiranya. Hiranya is nothing but sale and purchase of gold. If anyone is purchasing gold, they have to pay certain amount of tax to the government. And if anyone is selling that gold, he also needs to pay certain amount of tax to the government. That is Hiranya. Halivakar. Hal means plow. A person who is having his own land, or a person who is having his own agricultural tools and implements for what we say conducting agricultural practices, he needs to pay the tax to the government, and that tax is called as Halivakar. Okay, then Verinag, social security kind of tax. Example, if there is an unforeseen situation like any disaster, like suppose there is a flood, if there is a famine, so in that case the government needs to maintain certain amount of money so that it can spend that money in unforeseen situation like this. So that is why the government collects a tax which is called as social security tax. That is Verinag. If anyone is selling the land and if someone is purchasing the land, both have to pay the tax to the government, and that tax is called as clipped. I repeat, that is called as excuse me, that tax is called as clipped. That is tax involved in sale and purchase of land. Shulk, that is custom duty. Suppose if I am a merchant, I am going from one province to the other province to sell my goods, and I sell cotton textile. Okay, so as soon as I cross the border of my province, I have to pay certain amount as an octroi tax. As soon as I enter the borders of the other kingdom or other province, I had to pay the entry tax. That is referred as octroi. So these are the major taxes that were imposed on the people during the Gupta period. Did you understand the points? Please let me know. Yes, guys. Muskan, after the Guptas, I will be starting with a topic majorly. Tomorrow I will be covering certain left part of the Guptas. Okay, and after that I will be starting with modern India, which is again very important from prelims perspective. Guys, here I am covering, because it's highly impossible to cover all the topics here, I am covering those topics which are very, very important from the prelims perspective. Okay, now let's talk about the economy. As I have told you previously, land revenue was a chief source of income for the Gupta rulers. So here again, agriculture was a chief occupation. Land was very fertile, and Gupta rulers did not interfere in any sort of economic activities. Okay. Now, here land trade as well as sea trade was prevalent. Like it is believed that Gupta rulers had good trading contact with the Roman kings. Okay, because lot many coins have been found in the what we say Pataliputra and the region where Gupta rulers had their sway. This simply exemplifies they had a very flourishing internal as well as external trade. Okay, there were many cloth and silk centers that developed during this period. Wood carving was another important industry that developed during this period. Shipbuilding was another important industry that developed during this period. There was guild of merchants, as I have told you previously, Sartwaha. There were lot many towns that flourished during this period. Now, irrigation facilities were also provided by the Gupta dynasty rulers. One more thing, guys. I have told you previously, Gupta rulers imposed all sorts of taxes on the people. And whatever money was accrued from the taxes was spent for the welfare of the people themselves. Okay, it was spent for the welfare of the peoples. So like, these rulers constructed proper roads. These rulers constructed proper sarais. What is sarais? Rest houses. I'll give you a small example. Suppose if I'm a merchant and I'm going from one province to other province to sell my goods. Okay. So probably if that distance is around 50 miles, so it will take me hardly 1 to 2, 2 to 3 days to reach that place. In that case, I need a rest place to rest. So proper sarais were constructed at every 8 miles. These are rest houses. The roads were being safeguarded by the soldiers so that there cannot be any robbery or plundering activities. Okay. So these are the steps that were taken by Gupta rulers. Irrigation facilities were developed by Gupta rulers. Dams were being constructed by Gupta rulers. Like Junagadh inscription states that there was a dam that was constructed around Sudarshan Lake by Pushyagupta. Pushyagupta was governor of Chandragupta Maurya. So Sudarshan Lake was being constructed by Pushyagupta, who was the governor of Chandragupta Maurya, the ruler of Mauryan dynasty. But that dam now requires repairing activities. So this dam was repaired by Paramdat, who was governor of Skandagupta during the Gupta dynasty's reign. Okay, there were trading activities in diamond, pearls, corals. Coral basically means munga. You might have heard that. Fine quality silk was imported from China. Okay, and it is believed that Samudragupta issued 8 different kind of gold coins. So economy was very flourishing during the reign of Gupta period. Did you understand this? Please let me know. Yes, guys. Yes, Monisha, we'll be doing that as well. I'll be conducting a section-wise test as well. Now, let's talk about the society. Okay. Now, Gupta rulers gave liberal donation and land grants to the Brahmins. And the land grants to the Brahmin was called as Brahmadeya or Agrahara. There was a question in the UPSC prelims exam, what is Agrahara or Brahmadeya? Agrahara or Brahmadeya is nothing but land grants that are given to the Brahmins by the Gupta dynasty rulers. Okay. Now, the status and the dignity of women at this time declined. If you remember in the start of the session itself, I have talked about this, that after the post-Vedic period, there was rise of Jainism and Buddhism, and there was decline of Hinduism. But with the arrival of Guptas, there was a revival of Hinduism and the practices of the post-Vedic period. So during the later Vedic period, Sati system was prevalent. Women were denied education. Women were not allowed to participate in the village assemblies like Sabha, Samiti, Gana, Vidhata. In very simple words, women were not a part of decision-making process. Then child marriage was prevalent. Same thing came up here. Like Sati system was there, child marriage was there, polygamy was prevalent among the higher caste. Okay. Then there was caste system became more rigid and it was followed very rigidly. And there was one more fifth caste. that is referred as untouchables or chandals. Such was the derogatory system of the society there in the Gupta period. Okay, like as I have told you previously, whatever money that was accrued from the people in the form of taxes, that money was spent on the people itself for the various welfare activities. Like rest houses were constructed for the travelers on the highway, free hospital service was there. Okay, so these rulers were majorly involved in all sorts of welfare activities. So did you understand about the society, guys? Please let me know. Yes, did you understand this, guys? Okay, now let's talk about food, dress and amusement. Okay, now according to one of the poets, Kalidas, okay, the food during the Gupta period was quite delicious and nutritious as well. Like it is believed that barley, wheat and rice were the staple crop. Various type of fruits were eaten. Honey was served to the guest. Okay, if you remember guys, during the post-Vedic period, we have seen that grit is nothing but butter which is served to the guest. Similarly here, honey was served to the guest. Both men and women, okay, like they, both of them were fond of ornaments. The ornaments majorly were of gold and silver. There was a separate dress for hunting. The kings usually used to wear the dress made up of silk. Okay, and it is believed that these people had different sources of entertainment such as music, dancing, horse racing, chariot racing, elephant riding and so on. These were the sources of entertainment or outdoor activities during the Gupta period. Okay, now let's talk about their religion. I've talked about Vaishnavism. Majority of the Gupta rulers, I have said majority. Majority of the Gupta rulers were staunch followers of Vaishnavism. That is either worship of Lord Vishnu or Lord Krishna or Lord Ram. But Chandragupta II was worshipper, majorly they were worshippers of Lord Vishnu. But Chandragupta II was worshipper of Lord, Krishna. Okay, that is why he is also referred as Param Bhagwat. There can be a probable question in the exam. Which among the following Gupta dynasty rulers was referred as Param Bhagwat? Okay, so it was Chandragupta II who was referred as Param Bhagwat. But there are various Gupta rulers who were also, they also believed in Shaivism. Like they were worshippers of Lord Shiva. I have talked about the ruler Kumar Gupta I. He can be considered one among them. Like they were also the worshippers of sun god. Okay, now during the Gupta period, there were also worship of Shaktism. Like Shaktism means worship of female goddess, Durga, Lakshmi, Saraswati, Kali and so on. My friends, if you remember, I have told you that sometimes on the Gupta coins, we can find the depiction of goddess Lakshmi. Okay, the goddess of prosperity. Okay guys, the goddess of prosperity. Now, it is said that although these rulers were worshippers of Vaishnavism, but they still revered and respected all the other religions. Like during the reign of Skandagupta, idols of 5 Tirthankars were established in Gorakhpur. So this simply exemplifies, they revered and respected all other religions. Like during the, second Jain council was held at Vallabhi. And this was patronized by Gupta. It was held during the Gupta period. Okay, so this is majorly about the Gupta rulers and the Gupta administration. Did you understand the points, guys? Please let me know. Yes, guys, did you understand the points? Yes, guys, if you like my lectures, okay, so please do subscribe to Unacademy and use my code AKOUS. I repeat the code AKOUS. So I'll be conducting a small sectional test. Like for prehistoric culture, I'll be conducting a small test. For Indus Valley civilization, for Vedic civilization, Mauryan Empire, Gupta Empire, the test would just consist of 8 to 10 questions. So that you can have a very good sectional preparation for the exam. Okay guys, so basically you will get the information about the test on my Telegram channel, that is unacademy_alokoja. I repeat, unacademy_alokoja. So guys, if you like my lectures, please do subscribe to Unacademy and use my code AKOUS. I repeat the code AKOUS. Thank you and have a very, very nice day. Bye-bye. Good night.